brought to you by Penguin.
Judges, Volume 2, by Michael Carroll, Maura McHugh, and Joseph Elliott Coleman. Read by Akko Mitchell, Madeleine Rose, and Laurence Bouvard.
Introduction. I've been asked by my editor, David Thomas Moore, to pen this introduction to the second omnibus of Judge's novellas, and I'm more than happy to do so, especially since the bulk of today's work so far has involved scanning old magazine articles for my comics blog and writing an irate diatribe about how narrative is not the same thing as exposition, actually. If you've read the first Judge's omnibus, you'll have seen some of the effects of the introduction of Special Prosecutor Eustace Fargo's new hardline Department of Justice to the United States of America in the early 2030s. It all began with Judge Dredd, Origins, by Dredd's creators John Wagner and Carlos Esquerra, which, almost 30 years after the character's debut in the British anthology comic 2000 AD, finally showed us how Dredd's world evolved from our own. But the stories of the first judges on the streets are only barely touched upon in Origins, so that's where we come in. When designing this series, David and I made a conscious decision to focus on the judges whose names didn't necessarily go down in history. They're not saving the world at every single turn. Most of the time, they're just doing their jobs, trying to keep the citizens alive and put the perps behind bars. Or put them in the ground. That's another option. The judges have the power to dispense instant justice. Someone commits a crime, and you, as the arresting judge, decide their punishment there and then. No trial. No getting off on a technicality. No appeals. You decide they're getting 10 years. They're going to serve 10 years. And it starts right now. No, they don't get a phone call. But in a decaying society, punishing the perps isn't always so straightforward, because first you've got to determine the difference between the real criminals and the desperate citizens just trying to survive. My novella, The Avalanche, kicked off the Judges series, with the first batch of judges arriving in a small Connecticut town, and their first case is the murder of one of their own. George Mann's Lone Wolf is a tense procedural thriller in which the judges have legally executed a serial killer on the street, only to discover that there's another victim out there somewhere, possibly still alive. And in When the Light Lay Still by Charles J. Eskew, a cop who has testified against his former partner for the avoidable killing of an innocent, signs up to become a judge. Response to the series has been amazing, I'm happy to report, and a little bit divisive, too, which is even better. Readers familiar with Judge Dredd and his world will know that there's a huge variety of different types of stories that can be told, so it was important to us not to produce cookie-cutter adventures. All three are very different books. The positive reaction to Judges has also led to a comic strip spin-off, Dreadnoughts, debuting soon, as I write this, in the Judge Dredd magazine, with a script by me and sumptuous art by John Higgins and Sally Jane Hurst. With this second set of three novellas, we've moved on to the 2040s. The judges have been established throughout the nation, but the old guard are still there, the remnants of the old ways that the judge system was designed to supplant. But any citizen of a nation that's been forcibly occupied by another, will tell you that the introduction of a new policing system does not, cannot, ever run smoothly. Same thing applies when a nation's own government decides to tackle crime with a new, uncompromising police force. Those who will suffer most aren't the criminals, but the ordinary people. In the short term, at least. But give it time and things will get better. That's the promise. It'll be worth it in the end. No pain, no gain. Am I right? In Psyche, Maura McHugh introduces a new and very powerful subdivision to the Department of Justice, SciDiv. If you think the ordinary judges are tough, wait until you encounter those who can judge you for your crimes before you've even committed them. It's an ingenious and memorable science fiction horror tale that skips between the 2040s and Dredd's era, 100 years on. Joseph Elliott Coleman's novella, The Patriots, is a tense, often frenetic thriller in which two judges find themselves facing overwhelming odds in a city that's clearly only hanging on by its splintering fingernails, and the discovery that the Department of Justice isn't the only organization attempting to rise to power. My own contribution to this omnibus, Golgotha, presents the story of Errol Kwan. All she ever wanted was to be a cop. But now the era of ordinary police officers is coming to an end, and she has to learn to cope with being one of the last of their number. I'm sure you're eager to get stuck in, dear readers, so I won't keep you much longer. But before we part, I'd like to thank Maura and Joseph for their excellent contributions to the world of the judges. David Thomas Moore for his oversight. That's the good kind of oversight, not the negligent kind. The cuddly crew of adorable editorial geniuses at Abaddon and Rebellion. And, as always, Judge Dredd's wonderful parents, John and Carlos. Next stop, the 2050s. Michael Carroll, Dublin, January 2020. Golgotha, Michael Carroll. For the faculty of St. Lawrence College, Loughlinstown, and especially Mr. Jerry Murtaugh, who taught me that every book needs good characters, an even gooder story, and the very goodest of writing. Prologue. St. Christopher, Connecticut, Tuesday, January 4th, 2033, 1752. Nino's gonna flake, Gabriel Drake Neeby told his boss. He's not built for this kind of pressure. The passenger seat of Romley's Tesla was warm and comfortable. And much as Gabe was afraid of Romley, part of him wanted the conversation to go on longer. It was cold out there, and the cops were pissed that one of their own had been shot by a judge. They were liable to take it out on anyone who crossed them. A block ahead, the four cop cars parked at awkward angles. In front of the main entrance to Mercy South Hospital were tinted orange by the setting winter sun. Romley pursed his lips. All Nino has to do is put an end to Officer Chaplin. Once that's done, Chaplin's colleagues will rebel against the judges. That'll give us time to recover our stock. Gabe's phone buzzed in his pocket, and he dug it out and flipped open the cover. Aw, man. That's not gonna happen now. He glanced to the side. Romley was still staring straight ahead towards the hospital, and as usual, wasn't showing any emotion. Nodge says the judges already destroyed the stock, piled it in the empty lot across from the factory, and just torched it. Damn, judges work fast. Yeah, they do. Romley tapped a rapid beat against the steering wheel with his thumbs. All right. So in your judgment, Nino is not going to be able to go through with it. I doubt it. He's no killer, Mr. Romley. I mean, not in cold blood like that. Is he still using? Gabe hesitated long enough that there was no need to answer. I see. I thought so. My own fault for relying on an addict. I should have dealt with him sooner, but he had such good contacts. More tapping on the steering wheel. But he's out of our reach now, and out of our control. Gabe's phone buzzed again. Aw, hell no. Now the senior judge is on the scene along with Captain Whitcomb. Nino's got no chance now. Another sidelong glance at Romley. He'll talk or he'll run. He's not going to be able to stand up to them. Okay.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.